I'm so excited to meet Drunk Spitzer. But...
Drunk Spitzer is very fun. Like, you should have seen him. When was it?
Drunk Spitzer on crutches.
Oh my goodness.
Drunk Spitzer is fun.
Band camp. He was drunk one day.
Really?
I don't blame him. I'm a shit.
When was he drunk?
I wish
when
I
did I miss
been.
This?
Okay, the same day as like headlights.
Oh.
What?
Poor Elena.
Who?
No, Hersey.
Oh,
Hersey.
So
headlights.
The ice cream social thing.
Yeah.
Wasn't it?
No, we never had that. Remember?
No, we did it during bank. Yeah, we did during.
Yeah.
I didn't go to that because I like left and Donna was like, what?
Maybe Spencer wasn't drunk. You were probably drunk, Anthony. You were probably
Probably.
Anthony, we need to talk about the, what was it? Scrabble and Kool-Aid? Do we need to talk about that night?
Kool-Aid.
You went to that?
Yeah. You rode with me.
Oh, yeah, I did go to that. Yeah.
I'm finding out some stuff.
You went to that good with me. That was pretty funny.
Yeah. We stayed for like 5 minutes, though.
That was 15, okay? That was
15. 15 minutes. I made that my goal.
Yeah.
Okay.
I did not get an email.
I sent you like any email.
Not get any email.
I got my flash drive. Can I just go do that?
Okay. Okay, but before you guys start, I want to ask you guys a question. Okay, it's going to take a couple of minutes. Okay. I'm my colleague and I were designing a clothing website, and for the research purpose. Basically, that website, you know, is selling winter coat. We're trying to come up with name, okay? I have these two names. I want you to tell me which one you like, okay? The first title is, the first name I come up with is called the Duck Walk Apparel. Duck. You know, duck or walk? Anymore? Okay. The second title I come up with is called a street jacket. As one word. So one first one is dog walk apparel. The second one is street jacket.
It's one on your target audience.
Huh?
I like the first one.
I like
the first one.
Yeah.
I like the first one.
Yeah. Everyone likes it when it's got the word apparel in it. That's just me.
Okay.
Well, American apparel.
Okay. Then I'll take the first one. Okay. That's it. Thank you.
Okay. Shall we start?
Yes.
Okay. So, our chapter was 27, and I apologize.
Can we have a marker real quick before we start?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
Oh, Anthony.
This is
stick
my
music
word
in the marker.
Hands.
This is
hands.
So, yeah, there was some confusion. We thought it was 27, and then...
31. And
then 31, and we were confused. So, I'm sorry that you guys had such last minute. Okay, so what is ethanol? Ethanol is a controversial energy source first popularized by Henry Ford, and it is the systematic chemical name for ethyl alcohol. It can be made from all kinds of different stuff.
Sugar cane, corn,
yeah, in
biomass.
The U.S. we make it from corn, and it's used as a fuel in internal combustion engines. That's the main use that we talked about in the chapter. So in 1896, Henry Ford invented the first automobile to run on pure ethanol. But obviously, engines now run on gas with ethanol sometimes mixed in. So, how is ethanol made?
We have like a 3 minute.
How ethanol is made? Ethanol can come from things that grow. Starchy crops, sweet crops, and even plants or trees. These are what we call cellulosic material. But how do those crops get from the field to your fuel tank? It's a process that starts by grinding the feedstock into small particles and pulverizing the starch into a fine powder. Now, add water, and you have a nice mash going. Add a special enzyme, and the starch breaks down into teensy-tiny little particles. Want to see the starch liquefy and reduce bacteria? Turn the mash way down low to simmer. Now crank up the heat and the starch breaks down even more. Cool. No, really. Cool the mash before adding a second enzyme. This one helps to convert the liquid starch to a sugar, or dextrose, as we science types call it. And now it's time for fermentation. Let's synchronize. For the next 48 hours, we're mixing mash and yeast. As all you chemists and magicians know, this is where the sugar, presto, changes to ethanol, and the natural carbon dioxide is separated. See this fermented mash? It contains about 10% ethanol. But which 10%? To extract that ethanol, crank up the heat again and watch the ethanol vaporize. Then cool, then condense into this splish-splash liquid form. Now, you want to purify the mix, so remove any remaining H2O. And what's left is ethanol, about 200 proof. Potent, but it can't be potable, which explains the next step. Add a small amount of gasoline, from 2 to 5%. That's called denaturing, and it's a requirement for all fuel-grade ethanol. What happens to the leftovers? Well, nothing goes to waste. The distiller's grain becomes a nutritious livestock feed, and carbon dioxide goes into carbonated beverages and dry ice. The remaining ethanol, like any fuel, is sold to distributors for delivery to neighborhood stations. What's in your pump? E10, a blend of 10% ethanol, can be used in almost any car manufactured since 1980. And E85, a blend that contains 85% ethanol, is for the increasing number of flex fuel vehicles on the road. Just so you know, the same process that converts corn into ethanol works with sugar too. And biomass, which is just another name for the waste from fields and forests. Today, look around. There are ethanol production plants all over the U.S., with more popping up all the time. That means more ethanol-enriched gasoline available in more places. So next time your tank is on E, fill her up with a high-performance, renewable, ethanol-enriched fuel. It's good for your car, because it runs cleaner and cooler. It's good for your country, because it adds American jobs and reduces U.S. dependence on foreign oil. And it's better for your environment, because it's a renewable fuel that greatly reduces harmful tailpipe emissions. And to think, it all started with corn. To learn more, visit our website at www.drive...
Okay, so...
So...
How do you put that?
So, I thought that video was interesting because it basically makes the opposite case from what the book makes at the end. Mm-hmm. It gives all the interesting arguments. So, ethanol is less efficient than gasoline. It takes large amounts of resources to produce. It is heavily subsidized out of taxpayer money for more than 30, it has been heavily subsidized out of taxpayer money for more than 30 years. It's protected under the Energy Policy Act. It's growing rapidly due to government mandates, and it's more efficient over a small scale rather than on a large scale like we're trying to use it today. And it is not affecting our dependence on foreign oil. So those are a bunch of facts.
Yeah.
And we're going to go into more detail about them. Okay, so here are some arguments that the video made and the book also addressed, and they're kind of
different.
Yeah, their replies. So, adding ethanol to gasoline reduces air pollution, yielding environmental benefits. That's what the proponents of ethanol say. This was true 15 years ago, but the EPA, which is
Environmental Protection Agency.
Yes, and it's trying to promote ethanol. It even now admits that ethanol offers no benefits compared to gasoline, straight gasoline, as far as environmentally concerned. It is renewable, people say. Corn can be replanted each year, and this has a really long rebuttal.
the first thing that the book talked about was that oil is, we're not gonna run out of oil. I think we've talked about that before, or we're not gonna run out of it in the foreseeable future. But the other thing is, ethanol uses fossil fuels and other resources, and so it actually takes more resources to produce ethanol than it does gasoline. So it kind of defeats the purpose. It has a high opportunity cost, which we're going to get. Should we do stuff like that now?
Yeah.
Okay. And this was one of the articles, the New York Times article, really talked about the opportunity cost of corn. So would you guys like to suggest some opportunity costs of using corn for ethanol?
It can be used for like human food or like other kind of organism food.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely food was a big one.
And kind of going on with that, if you haven't noticed lately, in the last couple of years, corn has not been making like it's supposed to. We actually, I want to say, what was it, last year, the year before that, we actually had a so-called corn shortage, and we ended up having to ship some of our corn that we normally would have used to, like, for other things, we had to ship it up somewhere else so they could feed the cows.
Mm-hmm.
So there's no guarantee. Yeah, you could plant the corn, but there's no guarantee it's going to make.
Yeah, so that was one thing they talked about, too, is if we're too heavily reliant on corn, what if corn fails? And then what are we going to do? Because we are so reliant on it for food. And what other things are can we use corn for instead of ethanol? There's a couple more things they had.
Is that, like, the main producer? Because I know they said that they use, like, barley and wheat.
In the U.S., they use corn. Okay. In Brazil, they use beet.
In Brazil, they use sugar cane.
And in Europe, they use beets.
Oh. Yeah, they use beets in Europe.
So, there's different. And corn is actually, one thing they talked about is corn is not an efficient way to make, the most efficient way to make ethanol. Brazil actually has, it's like, I think they said it's 30% more efficient to use mm-hmm. sugar cane. But we use corn because it's heavily subsidized, we'll talk about that later.
So, like, why? Like, couldn't you heavily subsidize anything else? Like, if we substituted it with wheat, we could also heavily subsidize that. Mm-hmm. So I'm not.
The thing about it is, like, Brazil used sugarcane, and because it's more efficient, it doesn't need to be subsidized.
So there's, like,
it can stand on its own.
Brazil using sugarcane, like, it costs less to get the ethanol.
Yeah, to make it.
That would be the opportunity cost of using corn, is that mm-hmm. They can subsidize it. Versus if we had sugarcane and they used that, they wouldn't make as much money.
Yeah, that's a good point. So we could use something else other than corn. They talked about it, so it's food for us, and it's also food for livestock. And then it also, there's large amounts of farmland in the U.S. that we don't use for different environmental reasons. There's different reasons. And eventually, so basically, this is what the New York Times article talked about. If I understand this correctly, the government pays farmers to not use this farmland because it's a good idea to not use the farmland. But eventually, the price of corn is going to go up enough that farmers are going to grow corn on that land anyway, because they can make more money growing corn than they can from the government by not growing anything.
So there's certain land that the government says don't grow anything on it,
yeah.
And we'll pay you not to grow it.
Yeah, and there's different reasons. I don't know the exact science behind it, but
I would say, like, a lot of preservation. Because, like,
yes,
if you just keep using land and using land and using land, then eventually you're going to run into a problem where you don't have land left.
Yeah.
There should be just land that is just there.
Yeah.
Like it's supposed to.
And I've done research on, as far as, like, corn goes, corn is really damaging to land. It's expensive to grow. It takes a lot of resources, like we talked about. But it's also, it just takes the fertility of the land.
The nutrients out of the land.
And so that's the reason why this government subsidized like resting the land. But eventually, either the government subsidies for resting the land are going to have to go up, or farmers are just going to plant the land anyway because they can make some money.
So, you said that they pay farmers to not use that land.
Mm-hmm.
Is that payment to the farmer subsidized too?
Yeah, that is a subsidy. So those are some of the opportunity costs of corn. That's it could be used for food supply and livestock, and or the land could just be rested. The New York Times article, you know, said we need to have our priorities right in our use of corn. We need to have, you know, our food is most important. We need to have food. We don't need to have a famine. And then our food for the livestock is also for us. And then any corn that goes to ethanol. It talked about how this use of corn for ethanol and the subsidies for corn for ethanol are eventually going to cause either a food shortage or a food inflation. Food costs are going to go up with that. And ethanol is actually very costly to transport. Gasoline and fossil fuels are much easier to transport.
So does it, like, because they said that, like, a lot of the U.S. only uses, like, it's a 10%, like, mix, so it's, like, only 10% of ethanol and the gas that we use. So does that 10% of ethanol really make a difference in how efficient our cars are running?
Yeah, we're going to talk about that. So it reduces our dependence on foreign oil. This has to do with what you're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
The impact of ethanol on foreign oil is very tiny. So basically, they said, what was the percentage?
For the biofuels that we have in the U.S., it only occurs from 3-6%, varying on year, of all that the U.S. uses for its energy. So, and ethanol is included in that. So whenever you think about it, we trade a lot with actually Canada and Mexico, because like you hear about the pipeline over in the West that they're trying to get coming down. Whereas if we had ethanol, it would affect them because we wouldn't be buying as much from them. But we still would be from the Persian Gulf area.
Yeah. So what really happens?
We're trading.
We're trying to be independent from the Persian Gulf area, but it wouldn't really impact that. And that they said, for ethanol to make a difference, it would have to be like 50%. We would have to use like 50% ethanol, and that's like total. We still have gas stations now that don't have ethanol in their gas. I know because my dad always likes to go to them. So right now we're only using 3-6%.
So in order for like ethanol to have an impact on our purchases of foreign oil,
mm-hmm.
there would have to be 50% in all gas stations.
Yeah. So 50% biofuels.
And that would use up around half of the area we have total to grow corn.
Yeah.
Well, then wouldn't that be an incentive for the government to subsidize more ethanol production, because then you could be making more ethanol, so that's more money in their pockets essentially, and you'd be reducing the foreign oil import. So like, I'm not saying that it's smart for the country as a whole, but I'm saying if you're thinking just in terms of the government and what would be good for them to get money in their pockets, it would make sense for them to.
Yeah, well, basically, they're saying, you know, we are reducing our dependence on foreign oil. They're saying we are doing this, but really they're not. And if they were subsidizing it enough, like, it's basically not possible.
Because ethanol's a lot more inefficient than gasoline.
Yeah, and it's really hard to make. And, the land mass that it takes to grow that much corn to produce that much ethanol, they basically said, you know, we can't reach that 50% mark the way we're making ethanol right now. Corn can't produce that much ethanol.
So basically, they can't really, like, feasibly get to a point where it would be economical, but
mm-hmm.
they're justifying it.
Yeah, they're saying it's economical, but they're actually not at that point, and they can't get to it. So Do you want
to? Yeah. All right, so we have a few, I'd say, vocab word terms that we want you guys to know before we get to the discussion questions, because if you didn't get a chance to do the reading, then you wouldn't have really what these terms meant. So the political economy, it's the use of economics to study the causes and consequences of political decision making. So it's whenever, say, someone's trying to lobby for this article, or not article,
bill.
Yeah, there we go. Bill to get passed because it'll help them in the long run financially.
Yeah, it's how economics impact politics, mm-hmm. or how politics impact economics.
And then the theory of rational ignorance. We didn't really have a great way to put it in this thing, so I'm just going to talk about it. All right, so imagine you elect all these little people down here. We're going to have all of them. Okay, they elect one person to be their senator. And they can't all look every single day to see what the senator does. Like, some people try to watch what they do, like who the people they elect. But if they say the senator, give me a face. If the senator makes it so that gas is 8 cents more expensive, but that's enough to pay the subsidies for. Subsidies, there you go, I can't understand that word, for the corn, for the ethanol, then the people aren't really going to, like, scream at them, because that's only about $50 per year for the average driver.
So, between 2004 and 2011, taxpayers have paid $20 billion in ethanol subsidies, which seems like a big amount, but the theory of rational ignorance says that because it's actually only $50 per driver per year.
They aren't really going to notice much.
They don't really,
And if they do, they aren't going to go.
They're not going to march on Washington because of $50 per year.
So using the economic concept, what would be the proper economic concept to describe this rational ignorance? So basically, the price gone up, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's just very slightly.
Mm-hmm.
But demand did not decrease.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Demand did not respond to that change.
It's inelastic.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay. That makes sense.
Good job.
We are not protesting ethanol subsidies as a population, generally speaking. Some people have opinions about it, but we're not going to Washington and complaining. But these people are. The chapter talked about Archer Daniels Midland, which is an ethanol selling company, and it makes and sells 1/5 of all ethanol sold for fuel. So it has a large market share. And also corn farmers really like ethanol because it increases their demand and also increases the price of corn, so they're getting paid more.
Okay.
So before you guys go to discussion question, I want to ask you guys something here. Earlier you mentioned that this what's going on with the subsidy eventually is going to it's going to lead to the inflation on the food price, right?
Mm-hmm.
Can you explain that? Why? Using the graph.
Why?
Okay.
Can you say that one more time for me?
Okay. So the subsidies that government is doing to ethanol is going to lead to an inflation in the food price. So that's what Book and you guys just mentioned, right?
Okay.
So I want you to explain, use economic concept and graph, why that will happen.
So,
I don't.
You got this.
You got this?
Got it.
So,
maybe.
Try it out.
Okay. So, the price of food is going to go up because the demand for corn.
Okay, so first I want you to have several graphs because several markets are relevant here, right? Okay, one market is the corn market.
Mm-hmm. The other market is probably the other kind of agricultural goods that contribute to the, that will mm-hmm. use to produce food. And then you have food market.
And then the food market, you said?
Yeah. Okay. I don't know how many you need. I just think okay. that all those
I don't know how the other group, I'm confused by that, but okay. So. So the demand for corn is going up, right?
So this is right. So think right? about it. Okay, so what is the policy right now? Mm-hmm. What is the policy? What's the policy we're talking about? Subsidies.
Yes.
Right? Mm-hmm. Okay, what is the direct impact of this policy? So which side, supply or demand, is going to be directly affected by this?
Supply.
You agree?
No. Wouldn't it be the
direct impact? Of course, equilibrium corn is going to be affected, you know, so quantity demand, quantity supply eventually, oh, but what is
the
side that will.
I thought it was demand too.
Yeah, wouldn't it be the demand? Because if the demand is going to increase if there is a subsidy.
Why the demand of what?
Well, the demand would increase because there's laws saying that you
have to pay.
That you have to. There's laws encouraging the use of ethanol.
Mm-hmm. Wouldn't right? supply that, increase because the subsidy lets the producer make more?
Okay. So yeah. The subsidy policy will directly impact the supply.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Because now you can produce it at a cheaper price. So the input cost is lower,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So the supply will go up.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So now I want to put ice prime on it. Ice prime. Yeah. And you guys were talking about the requirement about using the ethanol mm-hmm. in the gasoline. Okay. So is there any change on that regulation before and after? Because we're talking about because subsidy now we know directly affect the supply. Mm-hmm. Is there anything that would directly affect the demand? Is there any policy regulation that would directly affect the demand?
That the policy saying that gasoline should be mixed with ethanol
mm-hmm.
would affect the demand.
And when was that policy
it started? 2005, I believe.
2005.
Yeah.
Okay. They have to put at least.
Yeah. So before that, there was no need, right, to put ethanol. So that policy will affect the demand.
Okay.
Okay, so you put the demand, so how the demand is going to change?
The demand for ethanol will go up.
Yes.
So it'll move to the right too.
Mm-hmm. That's right. So yeah, we have to be very clear which policy is influencing which.
So will the
Okay. Okay. Mark the D prime. The demand, new demand.
Oh.
Yeah, it's fine. Yeah. All right. Okay. So both demand and supply have increased, right? Mm-hmm. So now what's going to happen to this equilibrium price and equilibrium quantity based on the graph?
The quantity will go up, but this price will stay the same.
The quantity will go up for sure, mm-hmm. right? But you really, just based on the graph, we really do not know what's going to happen to the price.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, it could go up and it could go down and could remain the same. Yeah, but we are sure that quantity in the market is going to be high.
And so would this be like before the new policy, the 2005 policy, this would be the
prior to, yeah, before 2005.
So there's really, yeah. Okay. So there's actually two.
Just want to dissect, you know, the policy to make you understand how that's affected our economy. Yeah. Okay.
I
have a question. Mm-hmm. How come we wouldn't know what the price would do?
Show them a graph that when the price is going to go up.
Okay.
Adjust one of them. Adjust, you know, demand supply. A little bit. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah. Whenever, say if supply would go like.
No. Make the supply go down now.
Hmm? Do you want the price go up or the supply go up?
Like she says, you know, how do you know the price is going to go up and down and remain the same? Is that your question?
Yes, that's
question. Right. So I want to draw supply that she can see that eventually the equilibrium price will go up.
Oh, so like if we put it like up here?
Yeah. You can do that.
Just so that, like extreme.
Like over here?
Still on the graph, but like right here.
She's telling you to do a new demand.
Yeah. So if we saw this, we'd say, oh yes, the price definitely went up. It's very obvious,
mm-hmm.
but because it's so close, is that why we can't tell? Yeah,
right.
Because it's so close.
Okay, all right.
Okay, so what it's telling you is,
yeah.
Okay, each policy is going to have some impact, okay? And depends on which policy's impact is bigger. And that's what tell us whether the price is going to go up or not.
Mm.
So let's say, you know, if the demand shifts really, really high like that, so that's telling us the policy that 2006, you know, the requirement ISNO, that policy has a lot of impact on the demand. If the magnitude of that impact is the dominant one compared to the subsidy, you know, impact, then we're going to see the increase of the price of the core. But if the other way around, if the impact from subsidy policy is a dominant, you know, impact, then the supply is going to shift this way, really, really, you know, it's going to shift the down a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Then you're going to see the equilibrium price go down.
So these are even because these are really even. The impact of both looks, we drew them pretty even. But if one was bigger or than the other, then we'd have a difference.
So both policy will make the equilibrium quantity higher for sure. But these two policies kind of counteract each other in terms of determining the price,
mm-hmm.
in terms of the price of the core. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, and that impacts.
So what do you think? Okay, I'm going to ask you a further question. So what do you think what happened in the real world based on what happened in the real world? Which graph is more proper to this to represent that?
Do
you guys know what I'm asking?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, which one would happen in the real world, whether it be
which
this
one?
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Well, seeing how you have to buy food no matter what, I think that if the demand were to go up that high, the price would go up and follow.
You guys eat corn, so we all eat corn, right?
Mm-hmm.
Just watch. I love corn. Just watch the price of corn, and you will know where it's located. I think the corn price has not changed much in the last 15 years based on what I observed in this area. So I would say it's pretty much remained the same.
Mm.
Okay?
I wonder if, because corn that we eat is different than corn that to produce ethanol, though, like different types. I wonder if there's a big difference between, like there
would
be-
purchasing price of the corn
of corn for
food and
like so corn, like if we buy an ear of corn,
mm-hmm.
that is a different type of corn than the corn that like goes into our
fruit.
High fructose corn syrup and our animal feed and our ethanol, that's a different
different kind of corn.
So I don't know if that kind of corn has
a good point, but I would say this two, the price of these two kind of corn probably kind of related.
Yeah.
Okay, let's keep going.
Okay. So So we want to talk about why food costs are going to go up. They talk about it going up. So the supply, they haven't said that food has gone up yet. They're saying food will go up because the supply of food is going to go down. The demand stays the same, but the supply of food is going to go down because there's not as much corn to produce the food. Mm-hmm. The corn's going into the ethanol. Is that right? Yeah. So the supply is that way. Yeah. And that causes the price to go up if we do another.
So that causes the price to go up.
Yeah. So either a food shortage or food inflation, which means food prices go up.
Another factor, you know, I'm thinking is the other agricultural goods that use food. Mm-hmm. Because when the government, a lot of people use their land to grow corn, you have less land to grow for the other edible goods. And then the supply of the other edible goods is going to go down, then again, the price will go up.
So that would be very similar to this.
Right, that's right. Yes. Okay, good. All right, thank you. Thank
okay,
you.
Shall we do the discussion questions?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You want to read them?
Okay.
Resilient ethanol producers who make ethanol from sugarcane have lower production costs than U.S. producers. Until 2012, Congress protected U.S. producers from resilient competition by imposing an import tariff of nearly 60 cents per gallon on Brazilian ethanol. If Congress really cares about protecting the environment and reducing our reliance on foreign crude oil, why do you suppose we had such a large tariff on ethanol? Right.
Because we were domestically like making our own ethanol with the corn. And I mean, the U.S. has always, the Congress always looks out for like the U.S. people. Mm-hmm. And so if you're being able to, you know, pay less to bring in more ethanol made from sugarcane, which is cheaper for Brazilians to afford, then the America's suffering because they're not being able to make it, and not only is the producers but the farmers and everybody is kind of affected. Mm-hmm. By that.
I agree with Blaine, but I was thinking that it's not so much about they're looking out for money more so than they're looking out for like people in general.
Yeah, I think it's pointing out that Congress's motive isn't what they're saying. They're saying, we really care about the environment, but actually, we really care about making money on ethanol.
Yeah.
Okay.
Anybody else? Anything like that?
I'm going to ask you guys another challenge question.
Okay. Go ahead.
Okay, so how
do
can
I need
you
to erase this?
Yeah, please. So here we talk about tariff, okay? So can you draw a graph and show how the tariff affect the equilibrium point and equilibrium price of the mm-hmm. domestic market? Make it bigger, pass me. Make it bigger. So we're talking about the, what market are we talking about?
Domestic market.
Okay.
So if they...
So the price of...
If they make a tariff on it, mm-hmm. then that means that they're going to want the supply, no, the demand for domestic things to go up, correct?
No, they're trying to limit... They're trying to limit the supply from going up. They don't want large amounts of imports, right?
That's right. They don't want large amounts of imports. So they're trying the supply. They're not decreasing the supply, but they're just trying to make sure that the supply.
It's not just their job. You, all of you, can contribute. Okay.
Well, if they're putting the price on it, they're not decreasing the supply, but they're decreasing the demand, are they not? Because the demand's going to go down if the price goes up. Maybe.
But the demand, yeah. We're talking about, when we talk about the market, we're talking about like what people are demanding. We're not,
I get what you're saying.
We're not talking about like,
right, but if
it makes sense in my head.
If the people are having to pay for, you know, the tariff, right? You know, if these companies who manufacture the and you know make the sugar cane into the ethanol, if they're paying for the tariff, so they're paying more than they could do it on their own.
Mm-hmm. Well, they're gonna be less interested.
Right,
in
and
importing.
That demand would drop because they're not gonna want, you know, if they can make it cheaper, more affordable. By themselves, they're not gonna pay.
But they're the ones. I agree with you. But they're the one. I think that impacts supply because they're the ones supplying. So if they, it is gonna cause them to not want to produce as much, and so that means the supply is gonna go down.
Okay. So yeah, I'm saying the demand for the suppliers, but really,
yeah.
I should just say the supply.
Yeah.
Right.
I think we agree.
So the supply will go down.
Because both supply on. Imports.
Okay, so we're talking about the imports, but
you had original idea is that the purpose is to decrease the import.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Start from there.
Okay.
That's the purpose.
Yeah.
To decrease the import.
So if we decrease the imports, that means the local, like the domestic market, has to produce more, right?
Okay, so. Let me ask you guys this. So do you guys remember what is the price, and if we do not import from Brazil, what is the domestic price on the on ethanol? Do you know the price?
I can't remember.
So 60 cents per gallon? That was for the tariff.
It said that...
I think it's...
It said something about, like, one of the articles said something about, like, domestic was,
Is a dollar or something?
Yeah.
I think it's $2 something or dollar something?
Two
something.
109.
109.
Oh, wait, okay. Wait, I have it right here. Okay.
Per gallon of fuel is lower than the price.
It's not in the book, it's in the article.
Yeah, in this one article. Sugar cane from Brazil is 83 cents per gallon, but sugar cane in the United States is 109. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, so
$1.09.
So, Anthony?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay, we put that $1.09.
Mm-hmm.
Where?
Right here.
Equilibrium price.
Yep.
Okay. And where is that 83?
That's how much they can sell it in Brazil.
36 cents? 83 cents. I can't see it. So put 83 cents down there too?
Mm-hmm.
And that's the price that they sell it in Brazil. That's not like the price they import it.
Okay. I know. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I want to draw a horizontal line across that. Okay, so now you guys can generalize.
Okay.
So what are you going to say now? Without tariff.
Without the tariff, the Brazilian ethanol would create a price ceiling.
Okay. Without tariff, Brazilian is going to sell it at 83 cents.
Mm-hmm.
The domestic provider will be forced to sell at that price as well. Otherwise, they'll be out of the market, right? So now the market price will be at 83 cents.
Yeah.
At 83 cents. Look at the
2 points.
The supply.
Yeah, look at the difference between the quantity demand and quantity supply, the draw that kind of thing.
Good job.
Mm-hmm. Okay, where is the quantity demanded? Where is the quantity supplied? Okay, so what does this tell you?
What does this? We have a shortage.
So if the domestic provider is going to sell ethanol at 83 cents, and they're not going to provide that much. They're only going to provide QS. They're only going to provide that level, but the quantity demanded is going to add that QD level.
Mm-hmm.
So what we have to do, we have all that shortage there has to be
put in by the Brazilians.
Imported from Brazil.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the amount of the import.
Okay.
Okay. So now you raise the tariff. You have the tariff applied on it.
Yes.
So it's going to improve, the price is going to increase from 83 cents to somewhere still below $1.00 after, right? It should be still below that.
It was still below it.
Still, it should be below. So draw another one that is close to 109, but it's still below.
So like a dollar?
Yeah, it's just a dollar.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So where's the tariff? Now you add here, all right? So at this price, the domestic provider would like to produce more. So the quantity supplied by the domestic provider will be more. Mm-hmm. And the quantity demand by the domestic consumers will be less. So now we have a smaller shortage.
Yes.
So the import amount and is only this much now. So that's how the tariff affect the domestic market.
Okay. And the article talked about how when the cost of the cost of ethanol in Brazil went down, the imports went up, and so that makes sense. So like even if this was lower.
Exactly.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay. Ethanol in the EU is made from beets, like we talked about earlier. The EU imposes a tariff of about 35 cents per gallon on imports of ethanol into the EU. Explain who wins and who loses due to this tariff. Consider both producers and consumers, and consider not just the EU, but also Brazil, where ethanol is produced more cheaply than it is in the EU. Who wins and who loses due to this tariff?
Anybody want to take a stab?
A lot of people have not talked today. It's the last time you're going to get great. So better.
Well, really, either way, it seemed like the would it be the consumers at the end that would catch it because of the tariff, they have to raise the Brazil has to raise their prices, and people are going to buy gas regardless of how much it costs anyway. So wouldn't it be the consumers that kind of lose at the end of that?
I would assume the consumers too, because I mean, even if they do make it harder for the producers to produce, they're just going to make it harder for the consumers, or like make it more expensive because they want to get back what they lost too. And the consumers like you need it, so you don't have a choice.
Did Carly, did you?
I don't know. I'm going to wait a second because I don't want to say it and not make sense.
You want to intervene?
Yeah, that's not
well,
right.
Yeah,
you want
yeah.
to this is like
okay.
What we just talked about.
I wish I wouldn't have erased that now.
I know.
Okay,
hold on.
I got this.
This is so
I understand
the EU
this
has the same
now.
Problem as you.
I understand this.
Make it a prettier, honestly. Oh, this is fun.
This is one. This one
making
just.
Making it pretty. Yeah. Here we go. I'll just make it dot. Why we can't see right this stuff. Okay. So.
I'm making it pretty.
Okay. Good.
Okay. So, this is what the original price is for the EU.
They don't give it, but whatever it is.
I'm just going to put the EU. Mm-hmm. And Brazil, just say, they can make it a lot cheaper.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
That wasn't straight at all. But with the tariff, they have to sell it here. Mm-hmm. So either way you look at it, the consumer is not having to pay as much, even if there is a gap in the economy that Brazil has to fill right here. Mm-hmm. The consumer is still not having to pay as much because their price is that far lower.
Mm-hmm.
So the consumer wins in this one, and Brazil wins. Correct.
So Brazil wins.
Guys, the question, who wins or who loses due to the tariff? So without tariff, what will be the consumer's gain? And after tariff, what will be the consumer's gain? And the compare these two. That's what the question is asking you.
Well, I was going to say the same thing about the consumers winning, but then I thought that maybe the EU producers are also winning, but Brazil producers are losing, if that makes sense.
So the tariff, if there wasn't a tariff, it would sell here.
Mm-hmm.
And so that would be the, right?
Yeah, down here.
But because of the tariff, it goes up. So the consumers are losing.
So the consumers are.
But the producers of in Europe, if there wasn't a tariff, it would be down here. At least it's getting closer.
Yeah, so the producers do win.
I want to give you guys more details on this. So basically, this question is about consumer surplus and producer surplus. Okay? I think we talked about this some time ago, right?
Yes.
Okay. Consumer surplus is consumers' gain from the market, and this is producers' profit, okay? So, how do we calculate? How do we know which area is which? Okay, so if I'm just going to have a standard graph here, okay? Okay, so if we just have this market supply and market demand like that, and this is the equilibrium price, then the consumer surplus is the area between the demand and market price. So market price is right here, and this area is consumer surplus. And producer surplus is the area between the supply and market price. So it will be right here, okay? So if there's no other, the policies or no tariff tax going on, and that's what happened to producer surplus and consumer surplus, all right? Okay, so everybody's following me on that?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay, so now, okay, so we have tariff, okay? So again, the equilibrium price is still here, and Brazil's price is here. So you will have this free trade if we can import Brazil's product at this price, okay? And we know the domestic providers are only going to want to provide this much, but domestic consumer want to demand this much, so this much will be imported. That's what we talked about just now, right? Okay, so under this scenario, how do we calculate this and this for the domestic consumers and domestic providers? So again, the same rule. Consumer surplus is area between the demand and the market price. So now this whole area here represent the consumer's gain, okay? Mm-hmm. And what about producer surplus? Again, same rule applies. It is area between the supply and the market price. Market price is right here, and supply is right here. So the producer surplus without tariff is this much, and consumer surplus is this whole area here. So, but if you add a tariff there, and it's right here, and you can see that the producer's surplus is going to increase.
Mm-hmm.
okay? But the consumer skin is going to be smaller than this. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So that is graphing behind. But you guys did right.
Yeah. So consumers are losing because of the tariff, and producers are winning.
Gaining.
Yeah.
I promise the next ones won't be as hard.
Hopefully. But we did not address the second part of the question.
Oh,
and also, like, so we have to also have to consider the producers in Brazil. It would just be the producers in Brazil, right? Or the consumer.
Okay, I want to read the second part. Consider both producer and consumer, and consider not just EU, but also Brazil. Where ethanol is produced more cheaply than... Okay, so they're talking about... So this market here, what I'm drawing is EU market. So they're saying another market that will be affected by all this stuff. That will be the Brazil.
Brazil.
Yeah, draw the market for Brazil. Just next to it. Just below it, yeah.
The rice that can be sold in Brazil is right here.
That's weird that they're exporting it, so their supply would go down.
Supply is going to be
there's,
before and after, right?
Yeah.
Okay. In the first scenario, they supply this much to the foreign market, right? Mm-hmm. In the second scenario, they only supply this much. Mm-hmm. So supply is going to be...
So the supply in Brazil is going to increase
mm-hmm.
because they're not exporting as much? Right?
Mm. Not sure. Mm. Not sure. Let me think about it. So supply is going to decrease. Yes. Yeah.
Going to decrease.
Did I leave a book in here? I'm really sorry.
Is that? Is there a book in here?
No. I'm sorry, guys.
Because that supply you're drawing is a supply for the domestic market. This question I really need to think about, because what we want to know is how this how the change of exporting going to affect the domestic supply.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it's going to make domestic supply higher when you export less. That I have to say I'm not sure.
Okay.
So just leave like that.
Yeah. Okay.
So I'm not sure about the Brazil part. Let's see. Why do you suppose the federal government gives special treatment to owners of fertile farmland rather than, say, automobile mechanics?
Because they're trying to protect our environment, because once the soil and the farmland is used up, there's nothing left. I mean, we can't replace it.
They want to be nicer to the people that grow their food rather than automobile mechanics, because, I mean, you can walk or ride a bike. There's other things you can do, but you're always going to need food.
I feel like it promotes, like, people to be a farmer instead of, like, a mechanic, because we don't really have that many farmers.
farmers also have like more to lose. Like if you think about it that way, like automotive like mechanics, they have like their shop, and you know, if they're hurting for customers, then they're gonna go under. But like farmers, they have like all of their farmland, and if like they lose all of their crop, like then not only do like they hurt, but then you know, whoever they supply to is gonna start hurting too.
To me, it seems like growing crops puts more, there's more of a market for growing crops because that goes into so many different forms of the economy than an automobile mechanic.
In the back.
I just gonna agree with everybody basically and say that they're nicer to farm them because for many different things you need like crops or like resources from the land and stuff like that. Whereas for automobile mechanics, you kind of just need tools.
Mm-hmm. Well, if we think about it, cars are always gonna need like some type of like something to fix them. Like something's always gonna break. And with like she said about the farmland, like that the crop is all they have. Mm-hmm. It's not like you can just fix it and get a new one.
Yeah. Kristen? I feel like, you know, the government probably wants to manipulate the farmers and their farmland probably later on. If they have something that they want, of course they're going to treat them nicely and give them special treatment so they can manipulate them into letting them use their things.
Well, because, like, I mean, we're talking about ethanol. Like, that was kind of what we were talking about before. So if you kind of go back to that, you know, the supply of the corn is needed for the ethanol.
Mm-hmm.
Rather than, you know, you have the people that can convert it and everything like that, but in order to be able to convert it, you have to have it.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, selling, you know, corn isn't necessarily the easiest thing to, or not the easiest, but not the most, you're not getting a lot of profit.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a very profitable, because yes, you have to sell a lot of it, but a lot of it, you know, when we had the whole seed controversy with Monsanto and everything, you know, so in order to, because we need the corn for the ethanol, you got to give them something to say, okay, you know, for fertile farmland with the corn, it needs to be produced.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, honestly, like, if you think about it, we need the farm, like, we need the farmland to live because it's our food, so, like, we can live without cars, we can walk, or there's other ways of transportation, but like we can't live without food. So I think that's why they focus a little bit more on farmland.
In my mind, it's like you help the people who can do more for you. So if you help the farmers, they'll do more for you. But if you didn't help the mechanic, then that's all right. I can go somewhere else. Things will work out, probably.
I was just going to say that they probably give special treatment to the farmland owners because it's not necessarily a lot of farmland owners. So, like, you know, you kind of have to work with what you have. But as far as, like, mechanics, it's like, you know, you have many mechanics. You can drive down the street and find different mechanics. It's not like...
But, okay, I kept reading this question for 20 times right now. Okay, because why they put automobile mechanics there to compare the farmland? Why not nothing else?
Because it's the mechanics that have to do with the ethanol and the engine.
Yeah, that's the reason,
right?
Yes. So, I mean, that's, you know, it's because both are relevant to the ethanol. Okay, so you have to think about, okay, so the basically government has a choice, okay, and they can either incentivize the farmers or they can incentivize automobile makers. Okay, so basically the question is why the government incentivize the farmers instead of automobile makers. I think that's the question.
I think it's a little bit poorly phrased because automobile mechanics would actually, when ethanol, my grandfather's a mechanic, and he says ethanol is horrible, it eats engines. And so he actually would gain from that because he fixes more cars, because every time my dad calls him up and says, hey, Dad, my car's broken, he says, well, did you put ethanol gas in it? Because that's why. So I think they should have put automobile makers, because they are going to have to change the way they make cars.
because of ethanol.
Yeah.
So they're the ones that are actually hurting, not the automobile mechanics. I think that's poorly put. But
so what you say again, the last sentence?
I think they should they should have put automobile makers because they're the ones that are gonna hurt because of ethanol.
Yeah.
Okay. From 2004 through 2011, the federal subsidy on U.S. ethanol production was roughly 50 cents per gallon. Use the theory of rational ignorance to explain why the ethanol subsidy was only about 50 cents per gallon rather than $5 per gallon. So we talked about...
Because the people would notice $5 per gallon. Because when you have 50 cents per gallon, that's probably a relatively insignificant amount when you think about the millions of taxpayers, but when it's $5 per gallon, that increases it tenfold. So.
Yeah.
Plus, they only have like such a small amount in gas. Like you said earlier, there's no way we could get up to like 50 or 60%. It's only like 10% mm-hmm. right now, I think. So, like, yeah, that's why. Because if they did it to 60, which they can't effectively, then the $5 would make people be like,
yeah. Oh. And so, and this is talking about the actual 50 cents per gallon of ethanol. It's not actually talking about per gallon of gasoline. So we don't actually pay 50 cents more per gallon of gasoline. Yeah. It's actually a much smaller amount. The EPA has approved the use of up to 15% ethanol in fuel blends. Cars built before 2007 are at risk of considerable engine damage if run on such E15 fuel. Who will foot the bill for such damages if they occur?
The person that is driving the car that was made before 2007, which gives you, I guess it gives incentive to, you know, get a new car. Obviously, not everyone can do that. So if they were going to have to do that, then the government would have to implement like a trade-in or like a something to make sure that all cars are being able to use the E15 fuel.
Yeah. Yeah, I was wondering if it would... like the government would do something like that, or automakers would do something.
They
where
might
they have
put a recall out or something like that, but usually they only do that when your car's under that 5 year.
That would only be they made the mistake. Like,
right, exactly. And I mean, with the ethanol, I mean, it's the ethanol maker, so I mean.
Yeah, and because I was thinking, well, maybe if the people whose cars are messing up complained enough, the car manufacturers would change something, but that's probably not going to happen. It's probably be the government that would provide some kind of buyback program.
Actually, something that happened to my car, I accidentally put the wrong type of fuel in it, and because I didn't know, and actually I had to get the fuel tank replaced, the fuel pump replaced, and part of the engine had to be remade, and like I drive a BMW, so that was not cheap at all.
But even like you had to put the bill, like it
wouldn't. Exactly, I had to pay for it. Like nobody else. Like I could complain all I want. I could sue the gas company, but
yeah,
it's the consumer. It's
especially like right now because we're only at E10 for most gas is only E10. It's not as doesn't impact cars as much, but especially like small engines, it really impacts. If you put any ethanol in a small engine, then it's. You'd have to replace it.
Most car companies will say in like their little manual that they recommend premium anyway. So if you use like the low grade, they're kind of like, well, we told you.
Yep. Okay, why are foreign producers of products so often the subject of special taxes, such as the tax on imported ethanol? This is going back to what we were talking about with tariffs.
Kind of like the whole thing with the, you know, Brazil, like you're gonna, you want to have, you know, the U.S. is looking to make their money.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're gonna do that, you're gonna tax all the other imports because you're not making, you know, that you're not producing it. You're not needing the materials to produce it. And so you're just buying it from another country, which you know, if you import or if you put a tariff on it, then it says, okay, no, that's too much. I need to get it from America. I need to spend my money in the American economy kind of thing.
Yeah. So they're definitely trying to get people to buy from domestic producers, right? And so, but we talked about how without a tariff, consumers actually benefit, right? But with a tariff, producers benefit. So why is the government trying to benefit producers? I think that's what this question is asking. Trying to benefit domestic producers.
So you're saying, like, how does the tariff benefit domestic producers?
We talked about how it does benefit. So they're putting these tariffs, these special taxes, on foreign things to protect domestic producers, right? So why are they doing that?
So actually, this applies to all kinds of import. Okay, why any country wants to import anything from other country? It's because they're cheaper. Mm-hmm. Okay, and why any country want to put a barrier on the imports? Because they want to be protective of their own market. Okay, then why they want to be protective of their own market politically? Because when they run the election, who is going to contribute to their campaign? Now some foreign companies, right? Is the domestic big companies going to contribute, going to be the big donors to their campaign? Okay, so there is this lining of the interest. Okay, and I'm not saying that's all the reason why they protect domestic market, but it's one big reason they protect the domestic firms. You know, but every time you kill the competition, which is the tariff is, and the consumer is going to suffer.
Yeah,
there's no other way around it. Yeah.
Yeah. So going back to question number three, it's and what we talked about with who wins. It's these people are lobbying the government, and they're big. The different articles talk about how they're big government lobbyists. They have the voice in Washington, and they talked about how. The former executives from ADM are actually in the government now, so they're still seeking to they're in the government seeking to benefit ADM still. That's it, I think.
And isn't that's just like any company, if you have that, any big company is usually going to be the one for any product. You know, you've got the big companies that are the lobbying, and mm-hmm. the people that produce that are also lobbying.
Yeah. Any more comments?
Very good. All right, so on Thursday, we will not have class, but I will be in my office. A couple of things. If you want to turn in your paper by hand, you got to turn it to me, and then, okay, during the class time, I'll be there from 12:30 to 2 o'clock, 1:45. So I will be accepting papers. Or if you have any questions about your paper, you can come talk to me then. But if you don't turn me your hard copy by Thursday, then you have to email me by the deadline.
When you send us all an email, could you just email, or could you write it down which
one? I will write it down right now, the email address that you should use.
Yeah, because that's in the...
one of the problems.
The
problem is
supposed to be here. Yeah.
Is it due by the day that we're supposed to... Oh, this Friday?
No, it's Monday. It's due Monday, I don't
know. The day that we're
supposed
to...
What's our test day?
It's Monday.
It's due Monday
11 p.m.
Okay.
It's due Monday 11 p.m.
Yeah.
This is the email address you sent it to me. I will not accept a late submission.
Yeah.
So make sure you send me earlier than that. I will not accept.
I will respond.
Yeah. But if I were you, I would not wait until 10:59 to send it to me. Okay.
How many sources do we need for this effort? Like, how many total?
I mean, there is no requirement on that. But, okay, so again, I want to mention about the format of the paper, okay? And you're probably going to have a lot of good content, but I'm going to take a look at the citation when I put in your paper. I want the citation to look very professional, okay? And so basically, if you use any source and you have the cite, even you just copy a short sentence from, you're going to cite. I don't mind you cite a lot of things, but everything you cite, you have to give them the credit. Okay, the way you cite is exactly like the end of book. Okay, you know what I'm talking about? The end of book, those resources.
cite the way exactly how they cite it. You have the author, you have the year, you have the title of the article, you have the journal article or New York Times, whatever, then you have the volume, the page number, you have said exactly like that, okay?
But we're supposed to have in-text citations, so like every time we, like,
yeah, if you use, if
you
your copy is in
the author, right?
Yeah,
right.
You put author
and
the year.
Yeah.
And the year in the bracket.
And the, you're right,
is
the
that, that's APA?
APA
yeah.
style.
Yeah.
Okay, you like to use my paper, SH, you put bracket, 10/2014.
Okay.
In the set bracket. Okay, so every time you use other words, other people who you have to cite. If
so
I find out you use, you did not cite, you're going to lose points. Yeah.
So.